The Mamoudia rape and killings were war crimes involving the gang rape and murder of 14-year-old Iraqi girl Abir Qasim Hamza al-Janabi and the murder of her family by United States Army soldiers on March 12, 2006. It occurred in the family's house to the southwest of Yusufiya, a village to the west of the town of Al-Mamoudia, Iraq. Other members of al-Janabi's family murdered by Americans included her 34-year-old mother Fakriya Taha Muhassan, 45-year-old father Qasim Hamza Rahim, and 6-year-old sister Hadil Qasim Hamza al-Janabi. The two remaining survivors of the family, 9-year-old brother Ahmed and 11-year-old brother Mohammed, were at school during the massacre and orphaned by the event. 5 U.S. Army soldiers of the 502nd Infantry Regiment were charged with rape and murder. Specialist Paul E. Cortez, Specialist James P. Barker, Private First Class Jesse V. Spielman, Private First Class Brian L. Howard, and Private First Class Stephen D. Green. Green was discharged from the U.S. Army for mental instability before the crimes were known by his command, whereas Cortez, Barker, Spielman and Howard were tried by U.S. Army General Courts-Martial, convicted, and sentenced to prison. Green was tried and convicted in a United States civilian court and was sentenced to life in prison. Background. Abir Qasim Hamza al-Janabi, Arabic, Arabic letter Ain, Arabic letter B, Arabic letter Ye, Arabic letter Ra, Arabic letter Kaf, Arabic letter Aleph, Arabic letter Sin, Arabic letter Mim, Arabic letter Ha, Arabic letter Mim, Arabic letter Zain, Arabic letter Tamarbula, Arabic letter Aleph, Arabic letter Lam, Arabic letter Jim, Arabic letter Noon, Arabic letter Aleph, Arabic letter B, Arabic letter Ye, Abir Qasim Hamza al-Janabi, the 19th of August 1991, the 12th of March 2006, lived with her mother and father, Fakriya Taha Muhassan, 34, and Qasim Hamza Rahim, 45, respectively, and her 3 siblings, 6-year-old sister Hadil, 9-year-old brother Ahmed, and 11-year-old brother Mohammed. Of modest means, Abir's family lived in a one-bedroom house that they did not own, with borrowed furniture, in the village of Yusufiya, which lies west of the larger township of Al-Mamoudia, Iraq. The family was very close. Her father, Qasim, worked as a guard at a date orchard. Abir's mother, Fakriya, was a stay-at-home mom. According to her brothers, little Hadil, Abir's 6-year-old sister, loved a sweet plant that grew in the yard, was playful but not very mischievous, and enjoyed playing hide and seek with them. Qasim doted on his family, hoping that he would one day be able to buy a home for them and that they would live and eat like everyone else. He also had a dream that his children would finish college. According to her neighbors, at the time of the massacre, Abir spent most of her days at home, as her parents would not allow her to go to school because of security concerns. Having been born only months after the Gulf War, which devastated civilian infrastructure in Iraq, and living her entire life under sanctions, followed by the 2003 invasion and occupation of Iraq, Abir had dreams as well, hoping to one day live in the big city, Baghdad. Her relatives describe her as proud. Although she was only a 14-year-old child, Abir endured repeated sexual harassment from U.S. soldiers. Abir's home was situated approximately 200 meters, 220 yards, from a 6-man U.S. traffic checkpoint, TCP, southwest of the village. From their checkpoint, the soldiers would often watch Abir doing her chores and tending the garden. The neighbors had warned Abir's father of this, but he replied it was not a problem as she was just a small girl. Abir's brother Mohammed, who along with his younger brother was at school at the time of the murders and thus survived, recalls that the soldiers often searched the house. On one such occasion, Private First Class Stephen D. Green ran his index finger down Abir's cheek, an action which had terrified her. Abir's mother told her relatives before the murders that, whenever she caught the soldiers staring at Abir, they would give her the thumbs up sign, point to her daughter and say, "Very good, very good." Evidently this had concerned her and she made plans for Abir to spend nights sleeping at her uncle's, Ahmad Qasim's house. According to an affidavit later filed by the FBI, Green discussed raping the girl in the days preceding the event. Rape and murders on March 12, 2006, soldiers at the checkpoint from the 502nd Infantry Regiment, consisting of Green, Specialist Paul E. Cortez, Specialist James P. Barker, Private First Class Jesse V. Spielman, and Private First Class Brian L. Howard, had been playing cards, illegally drinking alcohol, whiskey mixed with an energy drink, hitting golf balls, and discussing plans to rape Abir and kill some Iraqis. Green was very persistent about killing some Iraqis and kept bringing up the idea. At some point, the group decided to go to Abir's home after they had seen her passing by their checkpoint earlier. The four soldiers of the six-man unit responsible for the checkpoint, Barker, Cortez, Green, and Spielman, then left their posts for ABR's home. Two men, Howard and another soldier, remained at the post. Howard had not been involved in discussions to rape and murder the family. He heard the four men talking about it and saw them leave, but thought they were joking and were planning to beat up some Iraqi men to blow off some steam. The sixth soldier at the checkpoint had no involvement. On the day of the massacre, ABR's father Qasim was enjoying time with his family while his sons were at school. In broad daylight, the five U.S. soldiers walked to the house, not wearing their uniforms, but wearing army-issue long underwear to look like ninjas, and separated 14-year-old Abir and her family into two different rooms. Spielman was responsible for grabbing ABR's six-year-old sister, who was outside the house with her father, and bringing her inside the house. Green then broke ABR's mother's arms, likely evidence of a struggle that resulted when she heard her daughter being raped in the other room and murdered her parents and younger sister, while two other soldiers, Cortez and Barker, raped Abir. Barker wrote that Cortez pushed Abir to the floor, lifted her dress, and tore off her underwear while she struggled. According to Cortez, Abir kept squirming and trying to keep her legs closed and saying stuff in Arabic, as he and Barker took turns holding her down and raping her. Cortez testified that Abir heard the gunshots in the room in which her parents and little sister were being held, causing her to scream and cry even more as she was being violently raped by the men. Green then emerged from the room saying, "I just killed them, all are dead." Green, who later said the crime was awesome, then raped Abir and shot her in the head several times. After the massacre, Barker poured petrol on Abir and the soldiers set fire to the lower part of the girl's body, from her stomach down to her feet. Barker testified that the soldiers gave Spielman their bloody clothes to burn and that he threw the AK-47 used to murder the family into a canal. They left to celebrate their crimes with a meal of chicken wings. Meanwhile, the fire from ABR's body eventually spread to the rest of the room, and the smoke alerted neighbors, who were among the first to discover the scene. One recalled, "The poor girl, she was so beautiful. She lay there, one leg was stretched and the other bent and her dress was lifted up to her neck." They ran to tell Abu Firas Janabi, ABR's uncle, that the farmhouse was on fire and that dead bodies could be seen inside the burning building. Janabi and his wife rushed to the farmhouse and doused some of the flames to get inside. Upon witnessing the scene inside, Janabi went to a checkpoint guarded by Iraqi army soldiers to report the crime. ABR's 9 and 11-year-old younger brothers, Ahmed and Mohammed, returned from school that afternoon to find smoke billowing from the windows. After going to their uncle's home, they returned to the house only to be traumatized, finding their father shot in the head, mother shot in the chest, 6-year-old sister Hadil shot in the face, and 14-year-old sister Abir's remains burning. The Iraqi soldiers immediately went to examine the scene and thereafter went to an American checkpoint to report the incident. This checkpoint was different from the one manned by the perpetrators. After approximately an hour, Some soldiers from the checkpoint went to the farmhouse. These soldiers were accompanied by at least one of the perpetrators. Cover up Green and the other soldiers who participated in the incident lied to the Iraqi soldiers who arrived on scene immediately after the incident, telling them that the massacre had been perpetrated by Sunni insurgents. These Iraqi soldiers conveyed this information to Abiyar's uncle, who viewed the bodies. This lie prevented the event from being recognized as a crime or widely reported amidst the widespread violence occurring during the occupation of Iraq. Sergeant Anthony Arribe learned of the massacre and told Private First Class Justin Watt, a newly assigned soldier to Bravo Company, that Green was a murderer. Watt conducted a personal inquiry about this alarming act by a fellow soldier and co-worker. He talked to other members of his platoon who revealed to him that the gang rape and murder had in fact occurred. Watt then reported what he believed to be true to another non-commissioned officer in his platoon, Sergeant John DM. Watt trusted DM. He told him that he knew a terrible crime had been committed and asked for his advice, knowing that if he reported the crime, he would be considered a traitor to his unit and could possibly be killed by them. DM told him to be cautious, but that he had a duty as an honorable soldier to report the crimes to the proper authorities. Unfortunately, they did not trust their chain of command to protect them if they reported a war crime. As a result, Watt asked to speak with a mental health counselor, thereby bypassing the chain of command to report the crimes. On June 22, 2006, the rape and the murders came to light when Watt revealed them during a mental health counseling session and then to Army criminal investigators. Before Watt reported the crimes, Green had previously been honorably discharged from the Army on May 16, 2006, before the crime was recognized with antisocial personality disorder. The FBI assumed jurisdiction for the crime committed by Green under the Military Extraterritorial Jurisdiction Act, and the U.S. Department of Justice charged him with the murders. Alleged 2006 retaliation. On July 10, the Mujahideen Shura Council, now a part of the Islamic State, released a graphic video showing the bodies of PFCS Tucker and Menchaca. This video was accompanied by a statement saying that the group carried out the killings as revenge for our sister who was dishonored by a soldier of the same brigade. The Washington Post reports that Charles Babineau and two other individuals from the same unit were captured and killed by militants a month after the rape. Local Iraqi officials and U.S. officials denied the killing of the GIs was an act of retaliation, because the soldiers were killed days before the revelation leaked out that U.S. soldiers had committed the massacre in Mamoudia. At the time of Menchaca and Tucker's abduction on June 16, 2006, only the perpetrators of the rape and murder, and a few soldiers in their unit engaged in covering up the crime, knew that it had been committed by U.S. soldiers. The crime was revealed by Watt on June 22, and American responsibility only became public knowledge in Iraq on July 4, days after which the video by the Mujahideen Shura Council was released. Also, the abduction occurred on June 16, 9 days after the targeted killing of the Shura Council's leader, Abu Musab al-Zarqawi. On June 7, the video from the Mujahideen Shura Council claimed that upon learning of the massacre, the group kept their anger to themselves and didn't spread the news, but were determined to avenge their sister's honor. Locals may have been able to deduce the guilt of the U.S. soldiers from the nearby checkpoint, after the Americans and their Iraqi cohort unit provided the explanation. Sunni extremists did this. A portion of locals served as auxiliary support for both for Al-Qaeda in Iraq and the 1920s Revolutionary Brigade. Auxiliary support comprised both material aid and performing a human intelligence support function. Relaying the accusation of the local MNCI unit to the insurgents was a basic function of that support. The Sunni extremists were able to eliminate themselves as suspects and, having an already low opinion of the U.S. military, may have assumed the guilt of the 101st Airborne soldiers. A statement issued along with the video stated that, God Almighty enabled them to capture two soldiers of the same brigade as this dirty crusader. Other militant groups also made various claims or statements announcing revenge campaigns after the killings were reported on July 4th, when the U.S. investigation into the incident was announced. On July 4th, Jaish al-Mujahideen claimed responsibility for downing a U.S. Army AH-64 Apache in retaliation for the child, Abir, whom U.S. soldiers raped in al-Mamudaya, south of Baghdad. On July 12, the Islamic Army in Iraq claimed responsibility for a suicide car bomb near the entrance to the Green Zone in Baghdad, in support of the Abir operations targeting the evil den in the Green Prison. Legal proceedings. Green was arrested as a civilian and convicted by a civilian court, the U.S. District Court in Paducah, Kentucky. The other four, all active duty soldiers, were convicted through courts martial. Stephen Dale Green. Green was arrested in North Carolina while traveling home from Arlington, Virginia, where he had attended the funeral of a soldier. On June 30, 2006, the FBI arrested Green, who was held without bond and transferred to Louisville, Kentucky. On July 3, federal prosecutors formally charged him with raping and murdering Abir, and with murdering her parents and younger sister. On July 10, the U.S. Army charged four other active duty soldiers with the same crime. A sixth soldier, Irib, was charged with failing to report the attack, but not with having participated in the massacre. On July 6, 2006, Green entered a plea of not guilty through his public defenders. U.S. Magistrate Judge James Moyer set an arraignment date of August 8 in Paducah, Kentucky. On July 11, his lawyers requested a gag order. This case has received prominent and often sensational coverage in virtually all print, electronic and internet news media in the world. Clearly, the publicity and public passion surrounding this case present the clear and imminent danger to the fair administration of justice, said the motion. Prosecutors had until July 25 to file their response to the request. On August 31, a federal judge rejected the gag order. U.S. District Judge Thomas Russell said there is no reason to believe that Green's right to a fair trial would be in jeopardy. Furthermore, he added, it is beyond question that the charges against Mr. Green are serious ones, and that some of the acts alleged in the complaint are considered unacceptable in our society. Opening arguments in Green's trial were heard on April 27, 2009. The prosecution rested its case on May 4. On May 7, 2009, Green was found guilty by the federal court in Kentucky of rape and multiple counts of murder. While prosecutors sought the death penalty in this case, jurors failed to agree unanimously and the death sentence could not be imposed. On September 4, Green was formally sentenced to life in prison with no possibility of parole. That Green was spared the death penalty provoked outrage from the family's relatives, with ABR's uncle describing the sentence as a crime almost worse than the soldier's crime. Green was held in the United States Penitentiary, Tucson, Arizona, and died on February 15, 2014, from complications following an attempt at suicide by hanging. Appeal. Green challenged his convictions, claiming that the Military Extraterritorial Jurisdiction Act is unconstitutional and that he should face a military trial. Green lost his appeal in August 2011. James P. Barker. On November 15, 2006, Specialist Barker pleaded guilty to rape and murder as part of a plea agreement requiring him to give evidence against the other soldiers to avoid the death penalty. He was sentenced to 90 years in prison and must serve 20 years before being considered for parole, following which he would be dishonorably discharged. Barker wept during closing statements and accepted responsibility for the rape and murders, saying the violence he had encountered in Iraq left him angry and mean toward Iraqis. Journalists reported he smoked a cigarette outside as a bailiff watched over him. He grinned but said nothing as reporters passed by. He is currently held in the United States Disciplinary Barracks at Fort Leavenworth, Kansas. Pauly Cortez on January 22, 2007. Cortez pleaded guilty in a court-martial to rape, conspiracy to rape, and four counts of murder as part of a plea deal to avoid the death penalty, and was sentenced to 100 years in prison followed by a dishonorable discharge. He wept as he apologized for the crimes, saying he could not explain why he took part. He is currently held in the United States Disciplinary Barracks at Fort Leavenworth, Kansas. Jesse V. Spielman. On August 3, 2007, Spielman, 23, was sentenced by a court-martial to 110 years in prison with the possibility of parole after 10 years, followed by a dishonorable discharge. He was convicted of rape, conspiracy to commit rape, house-raking with intent to rape, and four counts of felony murder. He had earlier pleaded guilty to lesser charges of conspiracy toward obstruction of justice, arson, wrongfully touching a corpse, and drinking. As of 2009, Spielman was held in the United States Disciplinary Barracks at Fort Leavenworth, Kansas. Brian L. Howard. Howard was sentenced by a court-martial under a plea agreement for obstruction of justice and being an accessory after the fact. The court found that his involvement included hearing the others discussing the crime and lying to protect them, but not commission of the actual rape or murders. Howard served a 27-month sentence, after which he was dishonorably discharged. Anthony W. Iribarib was initially charged with obstructing the investigation, specifically, dereliction of duty and making a false statement. In exchange for his testimony against the other men, the government dropped the charges against him and he accepted an administrative discharge characterized as other than honorable. Others. Justin Watt, the whistleblower, received a medical discharge and is now running a computer business. He says that he received death threats after coming forward. However, starting in 2010, he was asked by the U.S. Army Center for the Army Profession and Ethic, CAPE, at West Point, New York, to be interviewed and speak before Army profession audiences about his decision to report the crimes in accordance with his moral obligation to uphold the Army ethic. Watt and Sergeant Diem have both done so, including venues at which hundreds of senior Army leaders were present, for which their acts were given standing ovations. Survivors Muhammad and Ahmed Qasim Hamza Al-Janabi, the surviving brothers of murder victim Amir Qasim Hamza Al-Janabi, are being raised by an uncle, according to testimony in the court-martial of Cortez, Barker and Spielman. In popular culture, the 2007 war film Redacted is loosely based upon the events at Mamoudieh. The incident and the ensuing investigations were described in the book Black Hearts by Jim Frederick, published in 2010. The play, Nine Circles by Bill Kane, follows Daniel Reeves through the aftermath of Mamoudieh and was performed in 2011 at the Bootleg Theater in Los Angeles. The attacks are referenced in the 2017 episode, Fair Game, of the television series Homeland. The incident was covered extensively in March 2018 in Case 78 of Case File True Crime Podcast. The podcast also released an interview with Watt on February 1, 2020. The initial reporting of the incident is discussed firsthand by Watt in episodes Justin Watt Part 1 and Justin Watt Part 2, Inches of the Podcast Hazard Ground. See also Incident on Hill 192, Sexual Assault in the U.S. Military Freight on Board Ramrod Kill Team, Human Rights in Post Saddam Hussein Iraq Hamdani Incident, Haditha Massacre, Basra Prison Incident, Johnny Hackley Kandahar Massacre, United States War Crimes. References. External links. Video, The Rape and Murder Scene in Mamoudieh, short BBC documentary from August 7, 2006 images, The Mamoudieh Massacre images, a photo series resources, The Massacre of Mamoudieh, a full detail of the case with court documents, killings shattered dreams of rural Iraqi family. Associated Press at NBC News. 2009. Rape. American soldiers took turns. The age August 8, 2006. Stephen Green's apology to victims May 28, 2009, I came over here because I wanted to kill people. Andrew Tilghman, The Washington Post, Sunday, July 30, 2006. Lessons from UCFIA. From Black Hearts to Moral Education. Combined Arms Center. Army.mil Abir Qas Simhamza Al Janabi at Find a Grave Fakri Taha Musin at Find a Grave Hadil Qas Simhamza at Find a Grave Qas Simhamza Rahim at Find a Grave.